Hello my friends, Mina Geek here. Let me tell you something, making this video was a long and tedious journey. I just wanted to test a Core 2 Quad from 2007 in 2024 on Windows 10. This was supposed to be one of those fast videos. Shoot footage, script, edit and ready to go. 10 days later and I'm still not done. Thanks a lot, video. But before talking about the problems, let's see the good stuff. Because this video is about the legendary Core 2 Quad Q6600, the motherboard should be a socket 7751, and this MSI should do the trick. MSI P45 Neo 2, more exactly, version 1.1, with some nice cooling, the Dr. Moss cooling system. What? It's not Dr. Moss, it's Driver Moss? But this sounds worse. Anyway. Unfortunately, the motherboard only supports DDR2 memories, so I'll be using 8GB of DDR2 800MHz. The CPU is not a stranger to us hardcore geeks. Even normal geeks know very much about the Core 2 Quad Q6600. Its name will be forever engraved into our memories. Thank you, Intel! The video card I'm going to use is the well-known and still capable GeForce GTX 1070 from Asus. This should be enough to give some juice to the CPU. I'm using a 512GB brand new SSD. Unfortunately, I had some issues with the motherboard. It sometimes would not post after restart. So I've decided to change it to my trusted and beloved Gigabyte P35 DS4 and everything was smooth sailing from there on. And Windows 10 was installed in 1 hour. It takes a lot of time to boot, to install, to configure. It's very, very slow. I did all the updates in order to avoid them running in the background while doing stuff, and I've also disabled everything Windows Defender related. That's it. These are the only things I did regarding the operating system. Installing updates takes a heavy toll on the CPU, as expected, but it does not stay at 100%, no sir, it fluctuates between 60 and 90%. And now, browsing using Google Chrome. Opening the browser and doing a Google search is fast and snappy, the pages load very fast. The good old Vogons feels very smooth, and the CPU stays around 4 and 10%. The memory usage is 2.7 GB on a clean OS install, don't forget that. Going to a more demanding and filled with modernity website, apple.com, everything is in order. The website loads fast, the scrolling is smooth, and all the images are loaded without me noticing it. Doing the same thing on a Pentium 4 in the past was way worse, the images were loaded one by one. We have some bad loading times with the Wired website, but as soon as that obnoxious cookies dialogue thing is out of the way, everything feels okay. But what about YouTube? Subscribe to the Mina Geek channel, thanks! 720p YouTube is a fortress for the CPU, not the smallest hiccup or delay. Moving to 1080p, we have some frame drops, but not too many, and the video runs great. There you go guys, conclusive proof that this CPU is very fast even for Windows 10. Thank you all for watching!
No, no, geek, what about gaming? We're here for those sweet modern games!
Ok, I've installed Steam, Epic Store and GOG. Fallout 4 was installed in 33 minutes. I have gigabit internet connection, for your information. Actually, here is a list with some of the games I've installed and the duration. Counter-Strike 2 was installed in 50 minutes, and the CPU, surprisingly, was not capped at 100%. The Epic Store was installed in 4 minutes, compared to 5 minutes and 11 seconds on the Pentium 4 661. GTA 5 was installed in around 42 minutes, and during installation the CPU stays between 50 and 90% usage. Fortnite took around 33 minutes, but all was for nothing. Fortnite does not start. The legend has it that I'm still waiting for the game. Cyberpunk 2077 does not start, and although I've tried to use an SSE fix and a fix for older CPUs that don't have the proper instructions, I still could not make it work. Do you have any ideas? I've also tried an AVX fix, but I think that I did something wrong, I don't know. I've tested Doom 64, the GOG version, yeah I know, and the video card works. Now, unfortunately, while trying to install the latest video card drivers, Windows decided to crash. I was not worried, I've dealt with blue screens of death before, piece of cake. But not this one, no my friends, This one was too much for me to handle. Not technically, but psychically.
Psychically. Psychically. Psychically.
Maybe it was the late hour, lights off, and let the night be a good advisor. Linux Mint was installed in around 18 minutes compared to 2 hours for Windows 10. Now it's install time all over again. But wait a second, there's more. More problems, I mean. The sound card does not work. We have no sound. Doing some thorough online investigations, while drinking coffee of course, I found and downloaded the tool, but not using FileZilla, but using some terminal keyboard bashing and key smashing of Linux commands. In the end, I found Jack and installed it. No, Jack retasking for AHD Intel sound cards. By using this tool, stop right there. I want to take a moment and say that I love this, how in Linux there's a tool for absolutely everything under the sun. Thanks be to the entire Linux community of developers that invest their time into making these cool applications. Good job, guys! But don't forget, even though we're not Linux experts and sometimes ask stupid questions without giving you 10 pages of logs, try not to hate on us, okay? Please don't forget, in the year 2000, not everyone was running in 32... But how does the Q6600 handle Linux Mint? Well, it's way snappier and faster than on Windows 10, I can tell you that. Opening applications and working the desktop feels way better. Watching YouTube videos feels the same, just a few frame drops here and there, both for Windows and Linux. Installing Steam took 2 minutes on Linux and 3 seconds on Windows 10, but, and this is a big but, Linux games, because they use Proton and Vulkan, they must have their shaders compiled, and to do that takes a lot of time. In Fallout it takes 60 minutes. There you go, Todd, you've got your 60 minutes of graphics and shaders. Congratulations! And now, gaming. First, Red Dead Redemption 2 and Counter-Strike 2 don't start, at all. Sorry guys, no horse riding and getting bullied by bots in this night. And because we're retro enthusiasts, we need to start with older games. And what better game than Half-Life 1, released in 1999. We have locked 60fps no matter the area we're in. Going through the tunnel feels great and a great way to introduce the levels. And although I don't like when games don't let you play right from the start and don't let you skip the intro cutscene, this right here is not a cutscene. You can move the camera and look at stuff that interests you. So I will allow Half-Life 1 to be Half-Life 1. Inside the facility, everything looks gorgeous, with these fine textures, smooth colors, and nice composition. The FPS does not budge, so we're good. Great job, Gabe, sir! GTA 3. Maximum resolution and settings, and the game feels absolutely amazing. I was afraid of VSync, because Linux can't handle VSync properly, but no, the frame rate is capped at 60fps, and the game feels very smooth. I've tried some honest police work, because the police car moves very fast and I wanted to see if the game engine inside Linux, with Proton compatibility, can handle fast loadings and the maximum draw distance. And it can handle it, although you can see the drawing with your eyes. Not cool, guys, not cool. GTA 3's counterpart from the early 2000s, Mafia, does not run great. 60fps is a faraway dream in this game. We sometimes have 30-40fps. And although the game does not feel framey, you can still feel the frame drops. At least it plays better than playing it on Linux in 2002, I can tell you that. The game does not feel weird when moving the camera left-right, it does not have micro stutters like in Windows 10, which is great, I love me a smooth criminal. Get it? Because it's Mafia? But what about this mastermind move right here? Bam! Take that, mafiosos! And this is how you escape. No one's favorite shooter, Sirius Sam 2, okay, I'm joking, let's move on. Sirius Sam 2 does not run in full screen mode, it's in window mode with borders, the ugliest mode ever invented for a game. The game is not capped at 60fps and the frame rate is between 60 and 100 plus, which is great. All settings maxed out, of course. We don't need puzzle solving in Sirius Sam games, but instead we need chickens that play soccer inside the mini Dinamo Zagreb stadium, okay. Sirius Sam 2 runs great, let's go to the next game. And now we're moving to more modern times, with the amazing and so well optimized on PC, GTA 4. Optimized for making my life miserable, yes sir, because the frame rate is down, downtown, and the camera movement while driving drives me nuts. Again, the game is not full screen and I did not have high hopes for it, As I know that the PC version is very badly optimized. You'll need modern CPUs and more modern GPUs to play it properly. I'm using the maximum settings and it runs as badly with or without anti-aliasing, which is to be expected. The CPU is the biggest bottleneck here. But the visuals and the vibe in this game are beyond reproach. Just look at this dark blue, desaturated, misty city. Simply gorgeous. GTA 4 is the spiritual successor to GTA 3. Need for Speed Hot Pursuit 2010 was as fast on a Pentium 4 as my brain before coffee, but here we have a nice 60 FPS with some drops to 50. The game feels fine, no stutters, and it's full screen. Perfect. Nothing more to say about this game. You have a car in the road where you race other cars that are on the same road. Enjoy! Fallout 4 is the game from 2015 that still looks amazing even today, because, you know, visuals haven't evolved that much since then. I don't have the Steam frame counter because I had to disable Steam overlay, otherwise the game would not start. So you have to trust me to give you proper metrics regarding performance. I'm playing at 1600x1200 low settings, and the game does not drop under 30 FPS that often. But let's enjoy together this amazing scene from Fallout 4.
What? Confirmed reports, I repeat,
hey,
confirmed
Cosmo.
Reports of
Sir,
nuclear detonations
in
New York and Pennsylvania. My God.
Oh my God.
We need to get to the vault. Now!
I've got Sean. Let's go.
Codsworth, stay safe, buddy.
And your family as well, sir.
Residents of Sanctuary Hills, if you are registered, if you are registered.
Okay. Let me stop this for a second. What do you mean, if you are registered? So those not registered will die? Such a weird, greedy big corporation vibes right here. Wasn't the state supposed to offer these shelters? Welcome to real life, to a totally fictional game with totally fictional villains, which are the corporations. And then we have this, humankind at its best. Yeah, I'm depressed now, and to be honest and real, one of the best cures for depression, for me at least, is nostalgia. The older times were better glitch, and what better modern game that can also bring a lot of nostalgia than Mafia Definitive Edition. The game was released in 2020, it's a remake of the original Mafia released in 2002, and it's quite a looker. Mafia 2002 is one of my favorite games, but I still hadn't played the Definitive Edition more than 2 hours. I'm afraid that it won't be good enough for me, and it will ruin some of my past memories with the first Mafia. The game runs bad, a little slower than the earlier run for original Mafia, 25 plus FPS all the time. But yeah, let's be real, I'm playing an amazing looking game from 2020 on Linux with Proton on a quad core CPU from 2007. Don't forget that, the CPU is from 2007, clocked at 2.4 GHz, and although I'm using the lower settings, I'd say that this is quite an achievement. What do you guys think? Well done to the Q6600. Thank you, Intel. I'm sorry, my friends. This video was not what I wanted it to be, but it is what it is. Thank you all for watching, and until next time, have fun and be nostalgic.